in the midst of trials and tribulations, at the worst time of pain and suffering, we don't cry out, God, why me? We count it all joy and say, Lord, what are you working in me? How am I going to come out of this better than I went in? Because it's written, I will not be tempted past that I'm able to stand. And with every temptation, you make a way of escape. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers us out of them all. Hallelujah. Oh God, help us to believe.
Today on Sword of the Spirit, the Living Word.
To believe requires a corresponding action. There is no passivity in faith and belief. Amen? It's always on the offense. It's always moving forward, praise God. I read a great story the other day. It was, I can't remember if it was William Branham. No, it was John G. Lake, I think it was. And they were on their way to, I shared a few of these, and I don't know if I shared this one or not, but they were on their way to Australia. And as they journeyed, they got to where they were going to disembark and found out, they didn't know, that to disembark, you had to have $300. They didn't want vagabonds coming into the country, and so they learned of it as they were getting ready to disembark. And there was a line that had formed, and they were checking everybody. And his wife turned to him, and I hope this strikes home to us tonight. And his wife turned to him and said, "What are you going to do?" And he said, "I'm going to get in line." Amen? Now, two of these men of God experienced very similar things, and I'm going to give you both stories. I'm going to get in line. You've heard stories, I've known of men that God told them to go to such and such a place and to go drop a word to the church, had put a prophetic word in their heart and said, "I want you to go to Africa and drop this word." And so he packed. And everybody around him said, "What are you doing?" He said, "I'm going to the airport." "What do you mean?" "Well, God just spoke to me and said to go and drop this word, to bring this word." "Do you have any money?" "No." "Do you have, you know, a contact on the other side?" "No." "But I'm going to the airport." How many of you would head to the airport? How many people at that time start calling and sharing their testimonies? I want you to believe God with me. He told me to go to Africa, and I need $2,000. $2,000. And I'd like you to pray and tell other people, and if God lays on their heart $2,000, and we go around giving testimonies, God answered my prayer. We threw so many possibilities. We told everybody we know about our problem. And then we say, "Oh, God bless me." No, your friends blessed you. Now, can God use that method? Yes. But, oh, beloved, we're missing out on the sovereignty, the power, and the holiness of God, where He moves in a way that there is no doubt in your mind, there is no doubt in the devil's mind, that you are on a mission for God. Abraham said, "It will not be said that any man's blessed Abraham." Oh, those answers of prayer in our prayer closet, in secret, that God will reward us openly. Is there a time to let people know of needs? Yes, there are. And there's a time to be quiet in your prayer closet and let God reward you openly to where you'll never doubt again that God was your source. Can God move on people's hearts? Yes. They're already in Australia. He's second in line now. As people are disembarking, no money to get off the boat. And he wasn't getting out of line. Oh, how so many of us get out of line with one person left in front of us. I guess God didn't answer. And as he stepped up to the line and the man said, "Sir, how much money do you have?" "I only have $75. "No, you're mistaken," said a man sitting next to him. And he places $300 in his hand. And they go about Father's business. Or how about the one that, and I can't remember which one of these men it was, a very similar story. This one, Lake and them, when they got off the boat, they got on shore and they were traveling with another team, and a woman came running up and had asked them, had asked them, are you American missionaries? "Yes, we are." "How many are in your party?" "Well, there's myself and my two associates." "No, you're not the ones." And Lake's wife was saying, "Where are we going to stay? God will provide. We're going to need shelter for the children." I think they had like 5 children or more. And this lady came up and he said, "Well, there's another American missionary over here." And she went to them and said, "Are you a missionary from America?" "Yes." "How many are in your party?" 7. "My wife and I and 5 children." "You're the ones. God just spoke to me last week and said, there's a team coming from America with 5 children, and I want you to give them this house." Oh, to live in the Spirit. Oh, to live lives of faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please Him. Praise God. God is no respecter of persons. My question is, why not us? Are you willing to jeopardize yourself in faith? I mean, even in something as minor as being a fool in the eyes of others? How about at the peril of life when you're asked to step out of the boat? God has so many ways of answering prayer, and we try to pigeonhole Him into the way that we think's best. I shared there were 2 stories that were similar. One of them stepped up, and the man finally asked him, he said, "How much money do you have?" And he didn't tell him how much money he had. He said, "Sir, how much money do you have to claim and before the disembarking?" "And what is it that you plan on doing here?" And he said, "I plan on preaching the gospel of the kingdom in your nation. And I plan on God honoring His word and bringing men to eternal life, and Jesus healing sick bodies and casting out devils. And when I leave here, I'm going to India, and I'm going to Africa, and I'm going to Tibet, and I'm going to Japan to preach this same gospel. And the guys just looked at him and said, come on in, praise God. Amen. Amen? Somebody can hand you $3, or God can change the hearts and the eyes of those that stand before us. But without faith, it's impossible to please God. And now we can't go to the mission field without having funds enough to go, funds enough to come back, funds enough to provide for emergency. We have to have psychological profiling. That would whack half of us in itself. Oh, God, help us in our unbelief. And we receive the word with gladness. But then he says, when hard times come, in these three different parallel passages, you'll find that he speaks of three different things. He talks about persecutions, trials, afflictions. Now, Satan comes, the parable says, for the word's sake. These that receive it with joy, with gladness, and immediately life springs up. These are the ones that come in our midst, and they're just always praising Jesus. Have you ever noticed that newcomers show up, hallelujah, praising God, oh, the Lord's good, oh, hallelujah. And then a week later, you're like, where are they? Well, things got hard. I've been in this walk for a lot of years now. And I found that the people that come making the most noise usually don't stick. Receive it with joy. But when afflictions come and trials come, it's very interesting. It says they are immediately offended. Isn't that interesting? That word offended in the Greek means to be brought to distrust or to apostasy, apostatizing. The Greek word also is a word that we would put into the English that would say it scandalizes. It brings a scandal to the church. Don't you want him glorified in your life instead of scandalized? Don't you want the testimony of your life to be one that says they were faithful to their God? Turn over to Hebrews 11 for just a moment and let's look at a couple of those passages and ask ourselves, how do these people measure up in light of this parable that Jesus is teaching? They have no root in themselves, the scripture says. And so they're offended. I think as we look through the scriptures and read down to the latter part of this chapter, oh, we so love the first part of this chapter, don't we? And I think properly, of course, the Holy Spirit put all of these great observable victories first. Because we serve a God of victory. And we serve a God who wants to please each and every one of us. It's His good pleasure to give us His kingdom. He wants to daily load us with benefits, the scripture says. He wants to give us richly all things to enjoy. But things without trials will destroy you. Abundance without character will be your demise. Oh, how many of us lie to ourselves about our abilities to be able to handle more than God has given us. I wish I had the quote with me right now, but a number of the great brothers in the faith agreeing to that one principle, that all of the things in their life that have brought them the greatest pain and grief and sorrow have come to them through self-appropriation in giving themselves what they thought they deserved. Beyond the building or establishing of their character. And they went on to talk about how great it is to enjoy the blessings of the Lord that add no sorrow, the blessings that are given to the meek that inherit the earth, the blessings that come to those that are humble and have broken and contrite hearts. Oh, God wants us, beloved, His children, to prosper. But first to prosper in spirit. Amen. And in character. And in responsibility for our kingdom responsibilities. And so we read of this great cloud of witnesses and we contrast it with those in this parable. And he starts the chapter, and we're all so familiar with this. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. We've broken this down over the years, word by word, and we've dissected every word, and we've analyzed every word. And we've put in 5 and 6 scriptural illustrations of every word of this word. And none of it builds our faith. You can memorize this, study it in the Greek, dissect it. And if we're hearers and not doers, we've deceived ourselves. And that truth is not in us. You're not in faith if you're in fear. You're not in faith if ambition is driving you. You're not in faith when you're in competition. You're not in faith when you're trying to persuade others of your righteousness, your self-righteousness. He's speaking here, and I don't want to get off track tonight, but he's speaking here primarily concerning spiritual principles that have to do with our righteousness. And as we apply it throughout the revelation of redemption, we see that many of these principles have to do with the finished work of our righteousness. Too much emphasis has been put in these last days about faith and what it provides for us in our physical healing and in our financial prosperity and in our success and going ahead in the eyes of the world. And God does want to bless us in all of those ways, but don't ever lose sight that what He's first concerned about is your character, your spiritual life, your ability to know your righteousness in Jesus Christ. The ability to get up, as we shared a little earlier this evening, when you know that you've messed everything up through your lust and your lack of diligence and you failed God again. The devil says there's no hope for you, and you turn to chapter 11 and you say, I have a title deed to righteousness. And I am the righteousness of God in Jesus Christ. But oh, beloved, to continue to fail and stay on your course and exalt and give preeminence to your thoughts and your ambitions, to have a life that's so entrenched that you are not amendable to God moving you in any direction. You've already set your course, bless God, and nothing that agrees with my will can possibly be God. Then you've just become more spiritual than Jesus, because he said the greatest faith and communion you can have is to not to do your will, but the will of he that sent you. Oh, how entrenched we are in what we perceive to be truth. And then insist on putting it off on others. And in doing so, all we do is spread our unbelief. All we do is propagate self-will, self-confidence, preeminence, when the greatest among us is servant of all. Oh, God, help us in our faith. And the greatest faith you can appropriate tonight is the faith to once again offer yourself up on that cross. And declare, for me to live is Christ. Faith is the substance, the title deed. It is the foundation, the substrata, the assurance of things hoped for, favorably expected. Hope based upon the promises and revelation of the general will and purpose of God to his children. That absolute confidence in things that are now the proof, the exposing of things that are not seen, perceived, or experienced with the natural senses of life. It's true. I don't have to see it to believe it. I don't have to experience it for it to be true. What do you say about God and his promises in the midst of your pain and torment and afflictions and losses and fears and anxieties? Do you stand and say that God is good and that his promises are sure? Or do you find yourself murmuring and questioning, oh God, help our unbelief? We'll finish with this for tonight. We didn't get as far along as I'd hoped. He tells us, as we all know in verse 6, that without faith it's impossible to please God. But those that come to him must believe that he is, and that he's a rewarder of those that diligently, consistently, persistently, at all times, day and night, refuse to deviate from fellowship with God. Whatever has to go that I might spend more time with him. Whatever has to happen to get me 15 more minutes of quiet time with God. There's nothing, nothing but that one whisper, what that still small voice can do. When it comes to you, it will generate a faith and a power in you that'll shut the heavens up for 3.5 years. It will cause you to boldly take on the prophets of Baal. An audience with God. We asked a question a couple of sessions ago, and I wonder how you responded. What have you done to the last thing God required? What have you done with the last thing God required of you that you've left undone? Now, if we're wanting to hear more, we're going to have to finish what was begun in us. Amen? Don't expect more revelation. You haven't done what he told you. You're double-minded. Don't let that man think that he will receive anything from the Lord. The single-minded man hears and does. So my encouragement to you tonight is to stop, get quiet, ask God if there's anything left undone in your life, and then go back and fix it. And then we're ready to hear from him again.
Thank you for being with us today. We look forward to you joining us next week on Sword of the Spirit. We're here to proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord. If this message has ministered to, challenged, or inspired you, please visit us at swordofthespirit.org.